Well, good morning, Swift. Welcome to today's service, wherever you are. It's lovely to see you here today. And let's prepare our hearts to worship the Lord here today. Just a few announcements before we start. The first is, obviously, physical worship at the church premises hasn't started yet, but we want to ask you to join in prayer and ask the Lord to bring us back in His timing. Back to that premises. So do join in prayer, and we'll let everyone know when it is possible to get back to doing worship at Zhuentang in the main church premises. For now, we'll still be online. As well, the offering and tithes, if you since we cannot give that physically at the church, please feel free to send me a message if you haven't already, and I'll be able to get you in contact with the right way and many different ways that you can actually still continue to give your offering to Swift. All right, well, that's all for today, and let us join together and let us worship the Lord. So it's over to the praise team now.
Good morning, church. Let us come together in worship by reading the scriptures. Today's scriptures are taken from Psalm 34. We'll be reading together from verses 8 to 14. Let us read this together. Taste and see that the Lord is good. And blessed is the one who takes refuge in Him. Fear the Lord, you His holy people. For those who fear Him lack nothing. The lions may grow weak and hungry, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, my children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. And whoever of you loves life and desires to see many good days, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from telling lies. Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful, O God, that this morning we can come together as a body of Christ, as Swift, as one community, to worship You and to listen to Your word and Your voice. Thank You for Your words of affirmation written by the psalmist that comes from You. Thank You, Lord God, that we can cling onto these promises, that those who fear You lack nothing. And indeed, this morning we come before You knowing that we lack absolutely nothing, because we have the love of our Lord Jesus Christ in us. We have the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we have You, O God, who is Jehovah Jireh, our provider. Lord, this morning as we worship You, we want to come together and just unite our hearts and lay everything down at the altar and just focus upon that cross of Jesus, the cross that is more powerful than any other thing, the cross who saves us, and the cross who is able to draw us near to You. And I pray, O Lord, this morning, that as each and every one of us tune in to the service, may Your Holy Spirit draw us close to You, Lord. Help us, O Lord, to just worship You. Help us, O God, as we sing praise and worship songs to You, Lord, that You will be pleased with our hearts of worship. Lord, we want to worship You, O God, in spirit and in truth. So Your Holy Spirit, help us, please, as we commit this time of praise and worship into Your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Sorry, we got to stop because we can't hear the music here. But we can't hear the music. I'm so sorry, guys. It's, otherwise, we'll be singing like it's a cappella. And we start all over again. Our apologies. All right. We're good now. Let us prepare our hearts for worship. I know you could all hear us, but we couldn't hear ourselves just now. Here you go.
All I can say, all I can say, all I can say, all I can say, thank you for saving me and forgiving me. Thank you for loving me, my God. Thank you for healing me and for blessing me. Thank you for holding me, my God. Words can describe all the things in my heart, but I will endeavor to try. So with all my heart, I will thank you, God. And with all I am, I'll praise. For you're always good, and your love remains, my God. All I can say is thank you, my God. All I can say is thank you. Thank you for all the things you provide for me. Thank you for all you do, my God. Thank you for guiding me and protecting me. Thank you for who you are, my God. Words can describe all the things in my heart, but I will endeavor to try. So with all my heart, I will thank you, God, and with all I am, I praise. For you're always good, and your love remains, my God. All I can say is thank you, my God. For your healing power,
I thank you, Jesus.
For the victory,
I thank you, Jesus.
For your awesome presence,
I thank you, God.
For the greater level,
I thank you, Jesus.
Your anointing flowing,
I thank you, Jesus.
For your spirit,
your love remains, my God. All I can say is thank you, my God. All I can say is thank you.
For your healing power,
I thank you, Jesus.
For the victory,
I thank you, Jesus.
For your
Lord,
for the greater land.
we can say is to give you thanks and give you praise for your faithfulness. For your faithfulness, O God. For your mercy endures forever. Thank you, Jesus.
Standing on this mountain top, looking just how far you've come, knowing that for every step you are with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory is your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God. You are faithful. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory is your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God. You are faithful. You are faithful, God. You are faithful. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, never once did we ever walk alone. Carried by your constant grace, held within your perfect peace. Never once, no, we never walk alone. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful, God. You are faithful. And every step we are breathing in your grace, evermore we'll be breathing out your praise. You are faithful, God. You are faithful. You are faithful, God. You are faithful. You are faithful, God. You are faithful. Yes, you are faithful, Lord.
Yes, oh Lord, we worship a God who is forever faithful, whose love endures forever, whose grace is in abundance for each and every one of us. We thank you, O Lord, for your mercy and your grace. We thank you, O God, that your word says you will never leave us nor forsake us. We thank you, O Lord, that as far as the east is from the west, there you will cast the sins. Lord, you wash us white as snow, so we can come into your presence, into your embrace, to feel your mighty goodness. Lord, we thank you, God, for your mercy. We thank you, O Lord, that we are privileged to be able to listen to your words. And we pray right now in the name of Jesus, that as Pastor Vincent delivers your message that is for us this morning, may we not be just hearers of your words, but we will be doers, Lord. May we not just hear your words and just walk away and forget everything. But we will hear your word and we'll process your word and we will just embrace it into our hearts and put it into action so that, Lord, we and our lives can give you glory and honor that is due to your great and mighty name. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. Praise to Jesus.
Good morning, Swift. It's so good to see you all. Although all the other screens are blank. Oh, yeah, you have no voice. Yeah. Although all the other screens are blank, but I virtually meeting with you together while I was through the cyberspace. It's a great thing. Can you believe the Chinese New Year is over? And also it's at the end of February. So we're heading toward the last month of the first quarter of 2021. And keep as what Ian shared in the announcement that hopefully we'll be reopening pretty soon. So keep praying for it and we'll give you the latest updates once we have it. So far what I heard from the official and other sources, I think it's pretty positive for us to be able to reopen soon. As what I mentioned last time in the sermon, we should praise the Lord because what I've been told so far still haven't changed yet, that once the local church can be reopened, we can reopen at the same time. We don't need to go through any procedure or any delays. So please keep praying for it, for both the local church and us, so that we can all reopen together. We'll keep you updated. And hopefully we can come to the church premises to worship the Lord at least in the Easter Sunday. And also, if we do have our physical worship on Easter Sunday, which is April the 3rd, we will have a baptism. So far, we have two people signed up for it. If nothing changed, we will still have two people. And also, if you want to get baptized, since we don't have any baptism for a long while, please contact Ian in the office or you can send to info@swiftfamily.com to sign up because we need to have a baptismal class before the baptism. So please continue to pray for it so that we will have our baptismal worship service on the Easter Sunday. And before we start, let's do a quick prayer. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for letting us all come together to worship you. Lord, no matter where we are right now, but Lord, let us all united together under your Holy Spirit. Let the Holy Spirit guide us to open our hearts, humble ourselves, so we can listen to your word, especially starting from this week, we're going to have a mini series about the 10 plagues. Lord, help us to understand what it means to the people in thousands of years ago and also at the same time. What's that mean to us? We pray all this in Jesus' victorious name. Amen. As I mentioned, we are going through a mini series within Exodus on the plates. We're going to spend a few weeks, most likely on the month of March, on the first night plates. And then we'll do the last plate on the Easter Sunday, hopefully. Well, things may change, but this is the plan. And hopefully you will come to join us to stay through the whole series so you can understand, you have a different understanding of the 10 plates. Talk about the 10 plates in Exodus. What I feel like is going to watch an action movie. I mean, you know, in my age, I was excited when the first Transformer movie came out. I was so excited because I watched the animation of the Transformer when I was a little kid. I'm so excited to see a real robot to transform in the movie. But if you ever watch the Transformer movie, you know that you wait for almost half hour, actually over half hour, to see Optimus Prime finally transform. That's the excitement in the movie. I mean, 30 minutes after it starts. And after that, all the action comes in, and I enjoy the movie a lot. I think when I read the story of Exodus about the 10 plagues, I have the same feeling. Because if you read Exodus from chapter 1. You talk about the background, you talk about the king, forget the Pharaoh, forget Joseph. You talk about Moses being called. You talk about Moses reject God's offer, calling, and then God called him. And all these things happens in the first 6 chapter. Finally, in chapter 7, the action starts. The templates start with the templates. Although it's not a good thing, but at least the action starts. From there, God is acting on different things to bring and to deliver the Israelites to the promised land. So hopefully you feel the same excitement when you start reading the action part of Exodus. So before we start, let's take a look at today's outline. Today, I'm going to talk a little bit about the templates. And then we're going to focus on the water turned into the blood, the plate of blood. And I want to give you some background because in the template, probably many people have a question of why God hardened the heart of Pharaoh. I'm going to mention a little bit about that, but I want to reserve the discussion on why on about 2 weeks later. So today we're going to take a look at the overview of the template and also some background ideas and some lessons from the first plate. First of all, when we talk about the templates, you'll find out that's one main theme in this story, the whole story, basically even the whole story of Exodus. But in the part before the exile, God emphasized on one thing. If you remember what I mentioned on chapter 5, Pharaoh, when Moses and Aaron went to meet Pharaoh, and Pharaoh said, "Who is the Lord? What I should obey him? I should obey him and let Israel go? I do not know the Lord, and I will not let Israel go." So in here, Pharaoh answered God, basically, "I don't know you. Who are you? I don't care about you." So the main theme, actually, if you take a look at the templates, God is telling Pharaoh, "I will let you know who I am." You see, in chapter 7, you say, "He will not listen to you." That's what God told Moses, that Pharaoh will not listen to you, Moses. "Then I will lay my hand on Egypt, and with mighty acts of judgment, I will bring out my divisions and my people, the Israelites." So in here, God mentioned to Moses, I'm going to do the templates. One of the main reasons, because I want them to know, I'm going to put my mighty hand on that for judgment for them, for how they treat my people. And also, and the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord. If you have a chance to read through the whole book of Exodus, you'll find out that God emphasized on that. I am the Lord. I am the one. So this is the main thing for the Egyptians, what God wanted to emphasize to them. God wanted them to know, I am the Lord. I'm the creator. And I'm the almighty one. You have to listen to my demand, not even command, my demand that let my people go. So you can see, we all know from the story, Pharaoh refused, and even the officials, I mean, they refused. So at the end, God needs to show the his mighty power through the Red Sea, at the end of the Red Sea, and this end of the story of the Red Sea. So, but for Israelites, the theme is about the same. God wants Israelites to know that he is the Lord. But as I mentioned 2 weeks ago, that's one distinct differences. For Egyptian, God wanted them to know, I am God, and you have to obey, but I'm not related to you. I'm not going to associate with you. I'm going to give you punishment. I'm going to assert my judgment onto you. So at the end, Pharaoh and his army die in the Red Sea, as we all know. But for Israelites, the templates remodeled. I'm the Lord. I'm going to build up a relationship with you. I'm going to connect to you. I'm going to use this template to deliver you, to show the others, I am your God. So that's the major differences. But also, if you combine together, that's one main theme. God wants people to know he is God. If you bear in your mind about this, then I think the templates will have a lot of meaning to us. First, for the templates, one thing I want to share with you. This is Deuteronomy, is what I just mentioned, that Israelites is connected to God, and God want them to know that he is their God. Okay. And also, if you take a look at the templates, you find out there's a recurring emphasis on every three to four of them. So basically, if you take a look at the templates, it went into cycles of what? First of all, into the cycle of obedience. It talked about that not the Egyptians, Pharaoh, they need to obey. And also Moses and Aaron, they need to obey, because many times the beginning of the plate, the scripture will say, God told, God command, God order Aaron and Moses to talk to Pharaoh. It also, God told Moses and Aaron to perform different acts, different miracles or different plates. So this is, you need to obey Moses and Aaron. And also the Israelites, although the story haven't mentioned much about them yet, but it's also they need to obey, they need to trust in God. And also you talk about God's sovereignty, because you talk about God's almightiness. And it talk about, I will mention a little bit more later, we talk about how God, the only God, go against the gods that Egyptian believe. So God is almighty one. He control. If I'm going to show you in next week about the details on all the templates, how they order, how they structure, how people view it differently. But today I want to give you an overview. So first of all, the second emphasis on the sequence is on the cycles is on God's sovereignty. And the third is counterfeit signs. Today we're going to take a look when God, when or Moses used by God to perform the miracles or the plagues, that the magicians in Egyptians in Egypt, they can perform this similar things. So because of that, also Pharaoh saw this counterfeit signs that showing, oh yeah, this God is great, but it's not the greatest, kind of like that. So it's counterfeiting sign that at the end, it hardened Pharaoh's heart even further. So this will be an ongoing cycle on those plates. So we can see from the scripture, and it kind of like building up in every single cycle till the killing of the firstborn. So this is over overall structure of the templates. And then today we're going to take a look at the water turned into blood, the plate of the famous one. Okay, in the scripture, it says Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord had commanded. He raised his staff in the, sorry, I'm so far away from the screen, from the presence of Pharaoh and his officials, and strike the water of the Nile, and all the water was changed into blood. So the emphasis on the scripture saying the river Nile turned into blood. Some people thought it's the red clay or some sort of natural behavior that turned the water of the Nile to look like blood, to turn to red. But if you take further reading of the scripture, say the fish in the Nile died, and the river smelled so bad that the Egyptians could not drink its water. Blood was everywhere in Egypt. So first of all, from there, we know that it's not just changing color of water. As the character of the water changed, it smelled bad. The fish all dead, were all dead in there, in the river. So it really turned into blood, or at least something really strong. So we believe it turned into blood. Because if you know that there are many gods associated with the river Nile from the Egyptians. I hope I can pronounce this right. Okay, Osiris, Nu, and Hapi. So these three gods are associated with river Nile. And for Hapi, he even, they believe he controlled the bloodstream of the river Nile. So mainly it's like he provide all the water, he provide all the flowing of water in the river. But now the God who control the bloodstream of the river, he cannot face the blood, the water changed to blood. So I honestly, God changed water to blood to tell them I'm the only God. I'm the all powerful God that I can turn. I'm the one that really control the water and the river. And also beyond the water and river, according to the scripture, all the containers, everywhere they can contain water, turn the water in there turn into blood. So what happened? The Egyptians, they have a dump next to the Nile River to try to get water, because this play lasts for 7 days. We know that when I read the scripture, I always question, like, how can a person survive without drinking any water for 7 days, right? But according to the scripture, they dug along to the river Nile. Well, it seems like water came out from along the river. So, but also the magicians, they counted the miracles. They performed similar thing in front of Pharaoh. So they turned water into blood. So Pharaoh feel like, oh, they can do that. But what we believe, what they did is not turning water into blood. They turning water into red color water, because it's different. It never mentioned they can do exactly in the magnitude, first of all, from the river. And also they pretty much doing magic tricks to turn water to red. But ironically, they cannot turn, if they are powerful enough, they should be able to turn the blood into water, back to water, but they can't. They just able to show Pharaoh that, oh, we can do similar thing. That's all they did. So if you take a look at that, because of that, Pharaoh refused. And I really like to read this script, this particular part in this story, because they say, instead, he, which is Pharaoh turned and went into his palace and did not take even this to heart. And all the Egyptians dug along the Nile to get drinking water because they could not drink the water of the river. That's what I mentioned earlier. So the reason I find it is really interesting, because as the leader of the whole country, as the king, and people were suffer that they don't have water supply at all. So, but then what happened? He saw the magic done by the magician, and then he didn't take it seriously. He just not even taking, from the scripture, literally say, did not take even this to heart. He did not care. He thought it's okay, he'll be okay. But he will be fine, he thought. But if you take a look at the River Nile, do you know the importance of River Nile? It's not only that they draw water from it, they take bath from it, they cook from it, and also the fish fishing from the river to get food supply. And also the river is for their transportation, for import export, for commute to different places. So River Nile suddenly lost all its function. It's not providing water, it's not providing food. It smelled badly. Some people believe they may cause some disease because all fish were dead, and people cannot travel, and people not getting any goods in and out from Egypt. If I explain it in this way, do you feel that it's similar to what happened to us right now? I think during the Chinese New Year, one of the complaints from many people saying that we are stuck in Shanghai. We were all stuck in our own place. We cannot travel because it's a regulation after regulation in order for you to travel. And also it's a quarantine after quarantine if you travel. And also the worst thing is the air ticket can be so expensive. It can be so expensive, it's not worth it for a family to take off. And also, and even you can take off, you don't know what happened within your stay of the vacation and whether you can come back or not, right? So people complain that we've been stay for past 10 days on the Chinese New Year other than traveling like what happens before. But some people, told me that they have a good time with the family. They have a quiet time together. But no matter what, I think our life get affected since last year, almost the same time. And we don't know how much longer this is going to last. And some people are taking a vaccine in different countries, but hopefully things are getting better. But at least at this time, it's moving slowly, I would say. So when I read this scripture and prepare for the sermon, I really feel that, are we in the similar situation? I mean, although we're not relying on the river of Nile, but we're in the same situation. So if you take a look at why Pharaoh refused, maybe this can be a reminder for the world today. So why think about it? Why Pharaoh refused? Because God had performed multiple miracles. Before this, God did a pre-show to Pharaoh. He asked Aaron and Moses to turn their staff to snake. So Pharaoh saw that. But according to the scripture, the magician can do that. They could do that too. But then Aaron's and Moses' staff, they eat up their staff, or snake eat up their, they ate their snake. So that's the only difference. But that's a pre-show for Pharaoh. And also then now, the water turned into blood. If the water turns suddenly into blood, then maybe Pharaoh will say, oh, it's a coincidence. But if you think deeper about the story, Moses and Aaron already told Pharaoh, if you're not letting us to go, then this will be happen. This would happen. And Pharaoh, that's what we learned, he didn't care. So, and then it happened. So if you are the leader, if we are the leader of a country and someone come to me and tell me that something will happen, something extraordinary and abnormal, and something will happen that I should pay attention to, right? And if that thing, that prophecy did happen, I should pay attention to it. But seems like Pharaoh, he refused. Because of why? Because first of all, he feel like he need to release Israelites. So they're going to lose a lot of manpower. They're going to lose a lot of people to serve them. We believe at that time, the amount of, they have almost 2 million Israelites. And according to the scripture, we're going to read like weeks later, they have like over 600,000 men exiled from Egypt. So a big job force or workforce going to leave, Egypt if Pharaoh let it go. But I think this is not the main reason, because if you take a look at the history of Egypt, I don't think all their buildings, all their anomalous structures and construction were based on Hebrews, on the Israelites, because in the history, we never see because of the Israelites build the pyramids or any constructions. So I think from the scripture, I can sense Pharaoh, he refuses because what Moses and Aaron did to him was challenge his authority, his power, his leadership, his throne, his authority. So I asked the king of the country, of a strong country in that time, and who were you? You're two non-famous person just came to me and I need to listen to you. I think that's the part that making Pharaoh want to refuse. You challenge my authority. You challenge my control. I'm sure that I should be in control, but you come to me and say, I need to follow you. That's the problem. So if you take a look at nowadays, many people are hardened in their heart. Not necessarily in the way that Pharaoh refused God. But if you think about the good news, the gospel, we're going to talk more about the template, especially the last one, the Passover, how it associated, how it related to the Jesus' story in the New Testament. But if we take a look at the New Testament right now, so think about the gospel. Jesus came to tell people he's the Messiah. And what happened 2,000 years ago? People refused. And they crucified him on the cross. But God used that to glorify him by providing a salvation. So we have to be clear, God was not the one that crucified Jesus on the cross. It's the evil one. It's the people. It's the hardened heart. It's our wicked sin that we crucified Jesus at the cross. But God used it to provide ultimate salvation and ultimate good news to us. That's the main differences. So we should not think God killed Jesus on the cross. And also for that, Jesus being rejected, even God came to earth by himself. And then for the past 2,000 years, you can see lots of story about Christianity being rejected, refused. And even nowadays, do you think it's easy to evangelize to your friends, especially to your expat friends, for those who heard about the Bible story for years? It's hard, right? Sometimes when you try to evangelize to them, you try to share the good news to them, they thought they know it all. They thought this God is not related to me. They thought that I'm sophisticated. I have a good job. I have a good family. I'm even a good man. I never commit any crime. I'm be honored to my spouse. I treat my children great, and I even give a donation to different organizations. Basically, I'm a good man. So they don't feel they need the gospel. They feel they're sophisticated enough. But their view, their vision is only limited in their own life, right? They don't recognize. They don't realize, or they don't really care about eternity. But I think for the past year, the pandemic changed a lot of things. As I mentioned before, I mean, how many of us at this time, you will be certain what happened at the same time next year? Are we able to travel? Is the virus going to be gone? Are we able to have worship like what we have over a year ago? No one can tell you what will happen. Not even a year. How about, are we sure in 3 months we will be reopened, all our worship will be reopened, and then we can travel like what we can do like over a year ago? So not likely, but we're still not certain. We hope for the best, but we're not certain. So if we think from this thought, this line of thought, then think about it. Over a year ago, we thought we're in control. We have enough money to travel. We have a good job. I'm a good man. I don't have needs, and I'm not in danger. But after a year, I think we should outreach to our friends again if we haven't been doing that before. Because maybe they recognize something. Hopefully the pandemic is something that God, maybe he's not the active actor for doing the pandemic, but he allowed this thing happen for us to recognize something, for us to not to harden our heart to his gospel. So brother and sister in here, I urge you that we should be out of the surviving mode. For the past year, for the church, for the small group, for yourself, your spiritual life. Situation may last for a year or two longer. We don't know. I'm not saying it will be, but maybe. But we should turn our spiritual practice into more active and proactive, proactively to outreach the others. Because this is the time people need the gospel more than ever. Maybe you say, oh, Pastor, we don't have a physical worship. Maybe this is not a good time. No, this is the best time because we are doing it on Zoom. You can just call your friend and recheck them or I don't think you email your friend anymore anyway. So you call your friend or you can reach out to them and tell them we have a worship online. You can wear your pajama and join a worship as long as you like the screen, right? So you can come to join us without coming to the church premises yet. You can try that, right? And it's our job to how to give good feedback to your pastor, to the praise team, to the worship team, for us to know how to make this Zoom worship better and better. One thing I'm certain that even we can reopen a physical worship service next week, we'll continue to have the Zoom worship at the same time, because this is the way we can outreach to the one who cannot come to the church premises yet, and also for the one that maybe they are part of Swift, but they left China or they cannot come back yet. So we're going to keep the channel of the online worship available, not for you to be lazy, to take advantage of it, but for you to tell the others, we have one more channel to worship God together. So people ask, I mean, people have mentioned, comment and feedback and feelings about online worship, pros and cons. Some people feel it's great. Some people think it's not, because it's distract people from true worship. But my opinion, I think, if you think about the first century, that the first century Christian, because they've been persecuted, they cannot have worship service publicly. So what have they done? They worship in caves. They even find caves that have multiple entrance or exit. Depends how you call it, right? So if the government tried to arrest them coming from one entrance, they go get out from the other entrance. They try to find a cave that they have a way to go. They have a way out. That's the way they worship. But most important, they still do their best to worship God. So brother and sister, I think this is the attitude we should have. Maybe we're in the pandemic, we're in plight, right? We're in a tough situation. But we do our best to find a way to worship God. If the church provide a channel in Zoom, I will join at 10:45. If the church able to open the premises for adults, I will put my time at 2:00 to join the worship service. I'll even contribute and ask Sharon, ask Ian, ask me, ask Pastor Vincent, that how can I help? How can I serve? If the church, I can tell you right now, our offering dropped over 50%. Our congregation size dropped over 50%. But we still have the same expenses. We're in financial challenges right now. If you know about this and you pray to God, God, it's my way to show my respect and love. No matter where I am, I will still send my offering to you. Brothers and sisters, this is the attitude. I think God will be pleased in worshiping God. So it's not matter that we have the Zoom or not. It's not matter we have a physical worship or not. It's how we do our best to worship Him. I think that is become critical to how we can have a revival in Swift. So don't refuse God's sign. Don't refuse God's message. Don't refuse when God talking to us through different ways. So at the end, I want to ask one question. Who is your God? I can mention more about it. If you take a look at the river now again, why? The reason I mentioned about it is related to financial, related to food supplies, related to commerce, traveling. Not only because I want to map it to today's day, but think about it. Many people, we treating all the thing our God. You know why the Egyptians and other country, they're polytheists? They believe in multiple gods, because they want to gain the best advantage and benefits from different God who can provide different things. For them, the God is not God. Gods are servants for them. And ultimately, they are their own God. Same as Pharaoh. Pharaoh, at the end, when God challenged all the gods in gods of Egyptians, Pharaoh doesn't care, because Pharaoh feel, I am God. So brothers and sisters, nowadays, if we are not putting God as our highest priority. According to the scripture, if we have something that we with having higher priority than God, that become our God. That become our idols, because it's more important than God in your life. It could be your career. It could be your spouse. It could be your family. It could be yourself. It could be even a football game, if you know what I mean, from the United States. It could be some tournaments. It could be a car. It could be any possession you have. Brother and sister, when we revisit the story of the 10 plates, let's use it as a reminder for us that we examine ourselves, who is our God? If you believe the Father in heaven is our God, then let's add up together. Let's act on it to show the other Jesus is our Savior and our Father in heaven is our God, our Lord, that we will follow. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for wonderful grace that you always be with us. Your words always be true. And you always show us what will happen. You always told us what will happen for eternity. You always show us what will happen in the end days. Lord, although you haven't told us what will happen tomorrow or next week, but you told us, don't worry about tomorrow because we can put all the heavily laden onto you. Lord, let us have the faith in you. Let us all come together, give you our best. We don't need to be the best, but let us do our best to you. Let us worship together. Let us evangelize your name to our community. Let's serve you together so the others know that you are the only God. You are the creator and you are the savior. And also you are the deliverer at the end day. We pray all this in Jesus' victorious name. Amen.
You're able to do it. I know you can. God, you are faithful to move again. This mountain, it seems big, but I know you're with me. So Jesus, I'm grateful until very end. I can hear your voice singing over me. I'm free indeed, yeah. I can feel your power washing over me. I'm free indeed. You are my savior, so I won't fear, 'cause I know you've got this. Indeed, yeah, I can feel your heart. feel your power washing over me. I'm free indeed. I'm free indeed. I'm free
ahead and receive the benediction. May the love of our Father, the grace of His Son, Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us from now and forever. Amen.